morning and welcome to worship at the Cecil Lutheran Church in Cincinnati, Ohio. My name is Pastor Pat, and I am one of the pastors at the Shepherd. Today we continue our celebration of Easter, that Christ is risen, as we read how Jesus comes to his disciples while they gather behind closed doors. You might just say Jesus barges into their lives and changes everything. While we're worshiping, we invite you to join the live chat that is taking place on your screen. Let us know who is here and where you are from. Also, you may participate in the liturgy for the service, and you will find the words for your responses are included in the video. And now, may God bless us as we worship together today.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah! Refreshed by the resurrection life you share in Christ, let yourself to the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life. From tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us through the grace of water of rebirth, like rains to our thirsty country, like streams that abound in our souls, like cups of cool water that fill with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church. When we find you here, close us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we hear the word of life. Make us one with Christ. Cleanse our hearts, shower us with light. To you be given all praise of the Holy Spirit, the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you both. Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. Our grace of Christ among us enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and all that we do through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The first reading is from Acts the fourth chapter. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of free possessions, but everything was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or households sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold, they laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Here ends the reading. The Holy Gospel according to St. John. Glory to you, O Lord. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his thighs. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my fingers in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name, the Gospel of our Lord. Well, grace and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Here is the question for the day, straight from our gospel lesson. Are you a person who has doubts when it comes to your faith? Are you a person with rock solid faith? It's not an easy question to answer, is it? Well, listen to this strange story I found on the internet. In Mount Vernon, a small town in Texas, Drummond Farr has begun construction on a new building because it wanted to increase its business. A local church responded to the expansion by starting a campaign to block the bar from opening with prayers because it disapproved of the consumption of alcohol. Well, work progressed right up until the week before the opening, when lightning struck the bar and it burnt to the ground. The church folks were rather smug in their outlook after that, claiming the power of prayer had stopped the bar from expanding, until the bar owner sued the church on the grounds that the church was ultimately responsible for the demise of his building, either through direct or indirect actions or means. While the church vehemently denied all responsibility or connection to the building's demise, in its reply to the court. As the case made its way through the court, the judge looked over the paperwork. And at the hearing, he commented, "I don't know how I'm going to decide this case. It appears that we have a bar owner who believes in the power of prayer and an entire congregation that does not. So, who are the people who doubt in this story, and who are the people who have faith?" Well, it's the second Sunday after Easter. And not every year on the second Sunday after Easter, we hear the story of the disciples' encounter of the risen Jesus in the upper room. And we hear about four doubting comments who, for some reason, was not in the upper room when Jesus first appeared. And this is an interesting story. Yet the fact of the matter is this, that when Jesus encountered Thomas, Jesus didn't label him doubting Thomas. He didn't really judge him. He came to Thomas just as he was and offered him peace. And many would say that, you know, Thomas really isn't a doubter as much as a realist. And let's face it, a few years earlier, he had encountered reality like never before. When he saw his friend and teacher tried and nailed to a cross and died. When his friends tell him that they have seen the Lord, Thomas reacts with skepticism like any realist. The kind of maybe a terminally ill patient might have who has accepted their faith when they hear something like, "Oh, guess what? We have a miracle cure for you now." You can just hear that person say, "Sure." Well, I think one of the ways to understand our gospel text for today is to see that God takes us, accepts us where we are in life, with our doubt and our faith all mixed up inside of us at the same time. Well, you see, a week before Thomas ever touched the wounds of Jesus, the other disciples were sitting together in the upper room. It was the night of the first Easter, and I suspect that having denied and betrayed and abandoned Jesus, those disciples were wondering about what they had maybe done or not done. They were wondering about their failures. And it wouldn't be really a stretch to think that perhaps they were passing around blame for the death of Jesus. You could almost hear them saying it was the fault of the chief priest who condemned him. And you know what? There really wasn't enough room for us to be at the foot of the cross because all those women were there taking us to. And you can hear them thinking, maybe if that sleazy Jesus hadn't stolen out in the first place, this wouldn't have happened at all. It's kind of what we do when we know we've really blown it. But because of our truth of our own shortcomings is often too much for us to bear. Or maybe the disciples were behind the locked door because they were afraid of Jesus, because they had failed him so miserably. And the last person the disciples want to meet on that evening is a risen Jesus who might just confront them about their awful failures and kind of say, "Hey guys, where were you?" But anyway, they are there behind locked doors, blaming themselves, blaming their others, hiding and trying to figure out what Mary Magdalene meant when she said, "I've seen the Lord." And it is here, sitting there in the midst of their doubt and fear and locked doors, in the midst of their blame and justification, those disciples encounter the risen Jesus. It is here, at that place, he chose to appear to his beloved disciples, even though they had abandoned him. And notice this, that the text doesn't say when they had repented from being kind of jerks, if you will, when they had perfected their faith and the purity of the doctrine, then Jesus comes and says, worthy of receiving me? No, it is there in their fear and doubt, their betrayal, and probably a little shame that Jesus comes. And it takes more than locked doors and lack of faith and low self-esteem to keep Jesus away. In fact, when we are at the point in our lives when our failings and our shortcomings are so unfiltered, when we are at a point in life when we know we have completely blown it, when we are so undeniably aware of our need for God's grace, it is then that God comes to us just as we are, bringing us peace and forgiveness. It's just like God who marched in uninvited through our fear and locked doors to remind us, whether we like it or not, that we are forgiven, and that we are loved, and that we are treasured, and that we are God's beloved. God reminds us that we are more in the sum total of our bad choices, more than even the sum total of our good choices. God reminds us that we are His. For this whole thing is really an example of our God, who is always saying this consistent yes to all of our lives. No, thank you. No, thank you. Because a week later, their friend Thomas, who missed it all the first time, was with them in the same room. He had said, by the way, that Paul, no thank you to the news that Jesus had risen from the dead when his friends had told him they had seen the Lord. It's something we've all done, and yet he gets the name of daughter. But as though it makes you somehow distinct that that Badkey does that. But because the reality is this, we are all doubters. But something about doubt is this, that doubt isn't the opposite of faith, it's a component of having faith. A theologian, Brian McClare, recently wrote a book called Faith After Doubt, and he likes to say that faith does not exclude doubt. He says that doubting is essential to our faith because it makes us dive into it even deeper and to explore it even more. And doubt can mean that we haven't forgotten the story, that we're still listening. And the best thing about doubt is that at least we're being honest. We're not trying to stuff it away. We're being honest. I cannot tell you how many times as a pastor I've heard people say, you know what? I've been wondering about this. I've been wondering about that. How does this all go together? Well, over time, I think people who have doubts about their faith, like Thomas, have gotten a bad rap. It's like you're not faithful if you have a question about your faith. It's like you have to have your faith all tied up in a neat little package, and then you're truly a Christian. But the fact of the matter is that in the church there are many people who are active, but who still have doubts. Sometimes this will be because their faith is growing and they're exploring ideas they never explored before. They want to put it all together and say it's multidimensional. And sometimes it may be because people have experienced a tragedy or evil in the world. Doubt seems to be a natural response to these types of events in people's lives. I have read that during the pandemic, a lot of people have doubted their faith. And we also noticed that some of the greatest Christians that we know about have doubts of faith. Martin Luther did, Augustine of Hippo, even Mother Teresa, who was so committed to her mission. These are all people who are examples of people who have doubted. So doubt may be a very natural thing for us to have as the disciples of Jesus in our lives. And there is no sin in this. So, if that's where you are at, if you have doubts, or there's things about your faith that you still question, know it's okay. But you should be prepared for something. It's the thing you may never heard people in the church talk about, but it exists. It's called test of doubt. Not test of faith, but test of doubt. And you should probably watch out for them. Well, here's how one ELC pastor described her testimony. She says, "When I was sure that this whole Jesus thing had nothing to offer me, when I felt so alienated by some Christians I knew who judged me, and I was so clear about my dislike for organized religion, when I thought I had unwavering rock-solid doubts, I wandered into a church that challenged all my certainties I had about the Christian faith. It was my great crisis of doubt. Then I wandered into this little Lutheran church, and there I was freely given absolution. I was told that God loved me. I heard the gospel. I was literally given a chunk of bread, which I was told that it was Jesus, and it was for me. And I slowly began, because of all these things, to lose my doubt. So watch out, dear brothers and sisters. Watch out. Because here's the thing. It's not faith that is the biggest threat to doubt. The biggest threat to doubt is the bargain of God revealed in Christ, just like it was for Thomas and those other disciples in the upper room. So if you would like to protect your doubts, here are some things you might just keep at a distance that you might just try to stay away from. Avoid people who have heard the gospel and actually live as though it's true. Avoid talking about your doubt with other people. Avoid receiving communion where you receive something tangible that tells you God loves you. Avoid receiving forgiveness. Avoid receiving strangers, a way that God often does come to us. And by all means, don't sing hymns, don't come to worship, don't read God's word, for they are the most dangerous. And just politely continue to say, no thank you, no thank you. But know this, whether doubt is something that you fear or something that you foster, be prepared for it to be tempted again and again by a God who rudely barges into our locked doors and offers us peace and breath and spirit, and then sends us out to do the same for the world. God loves enough to keep saying yes to it, even though it often says no thank you. God says yes to it through the cross and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Be prepared for God to barge in, because that's the kind of doubt we have. Amen. In confessing our faith in the risen Christ. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is. being echoed to. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one deal with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy and Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God who promises to hear us and answer us in steadfast love. Lord, you shower your church with grace. Unite the whole church on earth so that with one heart it testifies to the resurrection of Jesus Christ with power and love. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Lord, you proclaim the blessing of life forevermore. Like dew upon the mountains, refresh your creation. Restore waters, cleanse the air, and provide revitalizing moisture to parched land. Give your co-creation the promise of new life. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Gracious God, you direct the nations. Guide all in authority, that they shepherd their people in ways of your love. Defeat in us our impulse to violence and hate. Bestow the peace of Christ upon those in authority, and breathe upon them the Holy Spirit. Hear us, O God, your mercy with grace. Lord, you place within the heart of the church a spirit of charity. Give us the power of your generous spirit that we provide for the needs of others in our Cincinnati community. Announce your peace to those who are sick, lonely, hurting, suffering, or afraid. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Lord, you give us fellowship with one another in the faith community of the Shepherd. Shine the light of the risen Christ in our life together, so that we may live in love for one another and our joy may be complete. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we pray the way Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We are glorious God, gracious Spirit, to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bless you, heaven and earth forever. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for worship today. We hope it fed your faith. If you would like to find out more about our mission, I invite you to check out the announcement page or go to our website, goodshepherd.com, and click on News and Events. We are truly long as a congregation to reflect the love of the risen Christ by all we say and do. If you would like to donate to our mission, you can go to our website and do so, or click on the link in the chat box. We thank you for your generosity. We'll see you next week, and now the dismissal. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Christ is risen indeed! Alleluia! Go in peace! Share the good news! Alleluia! Thanks be to God! Alleluia!
Hey, we're back, and guess what? We got another story for you. If you didn't see last week's, you should check it out. It was the Easter story of Jesus' resurrection, and this is happening right after the version where Mary was crying outside the tomb, right? And then who shows up?
Jesus.
But what did she? Who did she think he was?
A gardener.
A gardener, that's right. So in this version, the disciples are still all hiding, and Mary knows. Still hiding. That's right.
Yeah.
So we're going to find them in their little hold up little house. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Let's do this. Go team.
Go team.
Our story begins in the little house where the disciples were hiding, for they were afraid of suffering the same fate as their teacher, a grisly execution that had happened days before. Huddled in fear in the house, the disciples were terrified.
They're coming for us, you know. I know they're coming for us. Do you lock the door? Of course I did. I just hope they don't hear us in here.
When all of the sudden, in the room, while the door was locked, there shone a great light. And who was it? It was Jesus. He had appeared amongst them.
My goodness.
The disciples were all shocked and surprised, and Jesus spoke to them in their fear. "Peace be with you," he said. "Peace be with you. I have been sent from God, and now I am sending you. Receive the Holy Spirit." And he breathed the Spirit upon them. "Go, forgive sins. If you forgive sins, they're forgiven. Go, get back to it, gang. The mission is still at hand. Go with my peace. Go with the Spirit." The disciples were standing in amazement.
"He seems really bright. Can you see? Is that him?"
The disciples were in almost utter disbelief. But that's when they saw his hands. His hands still had the holes in them from his execution. And after breathing the Spirit upon them, he departed.
"Can you believe that?"
"I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't seen it myself."
Now Thomas, who you'll remember was the disciple who was brave and said he wanted to follow Jesus to Jerusalem, even if it meant their own death, was not in the locked room.
What?
What?
Where was he?
What? Where was Thomas?
Yeah.
Your guess is as good as mine. For all we know, he could have been getting food or supplies. "Hey, how many pizzas do you think I'll need for 12 people hiding in a house?"
"I don't know, maybe 6.
"Yeah, let's do that." Or he could have been out still doing what he always does, telling the story of Jesus. "Yeah, way I see it is he may be dead, but I'm not. And I still think there was a lot of good things he had to say. So if they want me to stop, they're going to have to arrest me." For all we know, he could have just been distraught and not know where to go in the midst of all this.
"Sir, you finished your pizza like an hour ago."
I don't know. I feel so lost.
"What brings you to Jerusalem?"
"I don't even know anymore." To his credit, Thomas wasn't hiding in a locked room.
"Hey, it's scary out there, you know."
True. When Thomas arrived to see the disciples later on, "Pizza's here." When he arrived, the house was abuzz.
"You'll never believe it, you'll never believe it, you'll never believe it."
"What are you talking about?"
"He was here, Jesus, and he was back, and there's holes in his hands."
"Holes in his hands?"
"I saw the whole thing. Lights, smoke, holes in his hands, it was real."
"What do you mean?"
"It was great and also kind of scary."
"Of course it was kind of scary, he's dead."
"Why is this such a surprise to all of you? I already told you I saw him."
"But now I've seen him, which is totally different." "Look guys, I think you've been cooped up in here way, way, way too long. No way, no offense, but I think it's because you've been inside. You need to get out. Only way I'm going to believe this is if I see it myself, if I can see the holes in his hands. It's just, you guys, this is kind of cruel what you're doing here." A week later, when the disciples were all huddled in the house, Thomas included, it happened again. Thomas could not believe his own eyes. "Peace be with you. Thomas, it's good to see you. My Lord, my God. Here, you wanted proof? Here, look at my hands." "Oh my goodness. I can't believe what I'm seeing." You believe because you've seen. Blessed are those who believe who haven't seen. It's true! Now, Jesus did many more miracles in their sight that aren't written here.
What?
What?
What else did he do?
What else did he do?
Yeah.
Your guess is as good as mine. It is finished.
Whoa, I've never seen anyone eat 6 pizzas before. Whoa.
Get a load of this, my disciples.
may you show them this? Pretty cool, right?
Regardless of what other miracles happened or what other signs he did, one thing was clear. Jesus was back. And this was written so that you would believe that Jesus is the Messiah. Hey, and that's what happened, basically. Except for those things where we were making guesses, but yeah. Thomas, right? Thomas is a great story, and it's great because it's so memorable, right? Like, people talk about Thomas a lot, and one of the things they use to describe him, sadly, is he's often referred to as Doubting Thomas because he didn't believe what the disciples saw. But I still think that's unfair because, like we said in the video, Thomas was often pretty brave and wanted to follow Jesus boldly, so he wasn't hiding with the other ones. We don't know what he was up to. He could have been doing anything. But calling him a doubter kind of has that negative connotation, but doubt isn't supposed to be a negative connotation. He just wanted to see for himself, right? Which is totally understandable. If you hear something unbelievable, you say, let me see. Show me. Thomas wanted to see, and we want to see too. But I think the word that when he does see that strikes me, that phrase where he says, my God, my Lord and my God. He's remembering, this is God, right? This is God. This is how God works. He's overwhelmed again by those feelings of being present with Jesus because he's back. And he says, yeah, when Jesus makes a promise, when God makes a promise, God keeps God's promises. In this case, it was that he said, I will return. I will be handed over to the authorities. I will suffer death, but I will return. God shows up when God says God will show up. That's great news. So for us, a question would be, where might we encounter God? Where is God promising to be around us? Because I don't know about you, but I want to see God. I want to see Jesus. So where is a place where we could see Jesus? Where's a place where Jesus promises to be? And one thing we have as a community is this communion, the opportunity to gather around the table and remember the night in which Jesus was betrayed when he said, do this. Do this in remembrance of me. This is me. This is my body. This is my blood. We're together. When I throw a party, I show up. So that's one way we encounter Jesus in this very tangible way. Remembering God is with us. God forgives us. So if we want to see Jesus, we can see Jesus in the body practicing communion. Or what about other promises Jesus made? Can we think of any that Jesus has made? How about just as you do to them, to the least of these, you do to me. So if you serve those who are in need, you are serving me. If you heal those who need healing, you're healing me. When you welcome the stranger, you're welcoming me. So if we want to see Jesus, we sometimes only need to look to the needs of our neighbors, look to the margins, to outside of our own bubbles and say, who is someone I can serve? Because in serving them, I know from Jesus' promise, I am serving Jesus. When I welcome a stranger, I am welcoming Jesus. Hard to believe sometimes, but my Lord, my God, it's true. We only need to listen and hear the words of Jesus' promise that even to the ends of the earth, I am with you. Even at your own dinner table, I am with you. When you remember this, I am with you. Even when you see your neighbors and their hearts for service and you care for your people who are in need, when you wash people's feet, when you care for people, you are serving me. So how can we meet Jesus this week? That's the question. Maybe it's here in worship. Maybe it's in service or care for our neighbors. If you find a way to serve your neighbor this week, I encourage you to do so because that's an opportunity to serve Jesus. It's an opportunity to meet Jesus. You find a way to welcome somebody who's feeling like they're on the outside, great news. You're welcoming Jesus. If you find a way to care for people who are being ignored, you're caring for Jesus. Because when Jesus promises, Jesus keeps those promises. When Jesus throws a party, Jesus shows up. So have a great week, everybody. Bye.